Good afternoon, everybody. It's a real honor to speak to you today and to welcome you to Northwestern University, where we're holding the Humanities Festival at this part of campus for the first time. We've had it downtown at the law school in previous occasions, but it's really an honor to welcome you all here today and to speak to you about my subject, which is lie detection. The theme of this year's conference, technology, is a plausible one-word definition you might look for of what makes a human being distinct, of course. There are few better descriptors of what makes us human than technology, and our species, it has often been said, might well be renamed Homo Faber. For better or worse, we are the tool-using animal. But here's another one-word descriptor I'd like you to try on for size. Human beings are liars. Other animals can resort to mimicry or camouflage, but only a human being can consciously hold one view in our mind while willfully expressing another with our words. No wonder so many moralists have deemed lying our most monstrous sin, seeing as it puts some of our most cherished human attributes, language, consciousness, and free will, to nefarious ends. Indeed, deception is so thoroughly human that the Russian poet Joseph Brodsky, who grew up surrounded by lies in the Soviet Union, actually turned this definition on its head. As he noted, it is not until we tell our first lie that we actually even know we are conscious. Now, my talk today explores the intersection of these all too human traits, technology and deception, but my goal is not to illustrate some universal human quality, but to learn what their intersection tells us about a specific historical time and place, the American 20th century. Now, the art of dissembling may be sufficiently advantageous to have been practiced by all people at all times in some fashion or other, but each society possesses its own unique characteristic institutions which claim to unmask liars. Now, one venerable approach has been to read mental dishonesty by the reactions of the body. The ancient Greeks looked for shifty eyes. Judges in India watched for curling toes. Chinese magistrates asked suspects to chew rice and spit it out on the assumption that only truth tellers would have sufficient saliva. And you may think that the same reason, or at least one hopes, lay behind the medieval demand that suspected perjurers lick a burning hot poker straight from the fire. Truth tellers' tongues, they thought, would survive such a thing, because, again, with enough saliva. And the Victorians had their own guidelines, including phrenological readings of the face and skull to catch tricksters, or interpreting blushes as God's way of exposing deceit. Now, the presumption with all these techniques is that our bodies will involuntarily betray our duplicity. The problem with all these techniques is that bodily signs can be equivocal, and the tricksters can master their outward show. And some children get pretty good at it, too. That's why in the early 20th century, Americans sought to peer beneath the skin to track the inner bodily signs that cannot be faked or willfully suppressed. To do this, they turned, as they have so often done, when confronted by a tough social challenge, to technology. The lie detector first assembled by Americans some 100 years ago came to be known as the polygraph, many images, because it recorded traces of multiple physiological parameters, the heartbeat, blood pressure, breathing depth, and galvanic skin resistance, which is just a fancy way of how sweaty you are. This assemblage of medical apparatus, call it the hardware of lie detection, had been off-the-shelf technology in Europe and the United States for decades already. Only in America was this apparatus then combined with new techniques of interrogation, called then the software of lie detection, by which operators claimed to distinguish an innocent person's honest reaction to a question about, say, murder, from that subject's understandably strong reaction to simply being interrogated about such a matter, say, by the police. Over the past century, lie detectors of this sort have been used to resolve criminal cases, gauge loyalty in the workplace, protect national security, and defend a person's reputation. Cast your mind over the scandals of yesteryear. O.J. Simpson, Anita Hill, Aldra James, Watergate, Jack Ruby, they've all had their lie detector moment. And that doesn't even account for, you know, the numerous appearances of it on the Murray Pava show, which I'm sure many of you have seen on your daytime television. And in a more systematic way, the Departments of Defense and Homeland Security have been deploying the lie detector in our current wars to expose terrorists and to verify the honesty of America's nuclear physicists. Yet across the same 100 years that it's been in use, psychologists have repeatedly denounced the reliability of lie detection as little more than guesswork in most ordinary situations. These conclusions have been underlined by reviews by the Congressional Office of Technology Assessment in 1983 and the National Academy of Sciences in 2003. Moreover, US criminal courts have largely rejected evidence from lie detection since its inception. And no other country in the world uses the lie detector to anything like the extent the United States does, where we use it about 2 million times a year. Yet every time scientists appear on the verge of killing this creature, it rises like the dead from like some horror movie Frankenstein. So the question I want to address today is not the scientific question of whether the lie detector works or not, but the far more intriguing historical question of why, despite this continual debunking, Americans continue to turn to it for answers. Of course, no technology can thrive unless its proponents convince their fellow citizens that it serves some purpose, right? But in the case of the lie detector, an additional act of persuasion was involved. That is because belief in the test was integral to how it worked. As its proponents acknowledged, the machine could not catch liars unless they feared being caught. To that extent, the history of the lie detector offers an example of the degree to which technology can reside and its power can reside in what medical science has determined the placebo effect. And for just that reason, the history of the lie detector can serve as a fascinating window into what we as Americans collectively believe. The 17th century polymath, Gottfried Leibniz, famously asked whether we would understand human consciousness any better if we could visit our minds as if taking a factory tour. At the turn of the 20th century, the psychologist Hugo Munsterberg created such a factory overlooking Harvard Yard, a lab filled with students aligning their inner feelings with their body's responses. As one Radcliffe student recalled, "Our pulses strapped to his recording needles and cylinders, we registered irrevocably our susceptibility to patriotism, romance, horror, joy, and a dozen other influences of daily life, and deception too." Munsterberg enthused that his psychological techniques would one day supplant the archaic methods by which the law determined the truth. And already in 1917, his work inspired the New York Times to dream of a justice grounded in scientific certainty. Quote, "There will soon be no jury, no horde of detectives and witnesses, no charges and countercharges, and no attorney for the defense. The state will merely submit all suspects in a case to the tests of the scientific instruments. And as these instruments cannot be made to lie or make mistakes, their evidence would be conclusive of guilt or innocence." In 1922, William Moulton Marston, a lawyer who had also trained in Munsterberg's lab, was invited to testify and verify the honesty of one James Alphonse Fry. Fry was an African-American from Washington, D.C., who had been accused of murdering a prominent physician, a black physician. Marston's test cleared Fry, but the judge refused to let Marston testify about this fact in front of the jury, a decision sustained in the very famous Fry ruling of 1923. For the next 70 years, this Fry ruling governed the rules by which all scientific evidence would or would not be led into court. So it's a very important precedent. And the rule held that the only kinds of sciences that would be admissible, which were those which had gained, quote, "general acceptance in the particular field in which it belongs." Now, that begs the question, what's the particular field in which it belongs? And instead of turning to enthusiastic polygraph operators like Marston to see whether they agreed with it and whether it worked in that field, the judges turned quite deliberately to academic psychologists who were skeptical of the result. After all, as several judges later admitted, if they did admit lie detector evidence into court and the jury believed that, what would be the point of the jury at all? It would basically decide the case, much as the New York Times had predicted. So you might think my story would end right there in 1923 with the Fry ruling, it's banned from the court. But in fact, this formal ban from the courtroom actually coincided with a vast increase in the use of the lie detector. How was this possible? This was the achievement of two disciples of August Vollmer, police chief of Berkeley, California, and the nation's foremost advocate of professional police work. He's really, in some ways, perhaps except for Hoover, the most important police officer ever in the history of the United States. He really is the man responsible for the very idea that the police can and should be professionals. Now, one of his disciples, the self-righteous college cop John Larson, had a PhD in physiology from Berkeley. And the other was a high school student and amateur magician named Leonard Keeler, who was named after Leonardo da Vinci, but decided to go less grandly by Nard. In the early 1920s, the two men worked collaboratively in Berkeley under Vollmer, but after both moved to Chicago in the late 1920s, they became rivals and then bitter enemies. Now, their common beliefs will help us understand what was particularly American about the lie detector, while their disagreements will help us understand its selective acceptance, why it's been banned from the courts and embraced by the criminal justice system, employers, the national security state, and the public. Let's begin with their common assumptions. John Larson was the nation's first PhD cop. In 1921, Larson was inspired by Marston's example to put the technique on a more scientific footing. Where Marston had taken intermittent blood pressure readings while the suspect recounted their story in the manner of a legal deposition, Larson, working with the Berkeley police, designed his assembly of instruments to make a continuous reading of physiological responses while the subject answered intermittent yes or no questions in the manner of a police interrogation, except as a control, Larson also included innocuous questions. This today is known as the relevant-irrelevant test. Finally, and most important, Larson found an ideal natural scientific experiment to test his method. For this, Larson needed a real crime to investigate, not some laboratory game. Yet the crime had to be committed by an insider, so they knew there'd be one guilty person, right, among the population he was testing. And that population had to be limited in number, homogeneous, healthy, able to follow instructions, and pretty unlikely to complain. Larson set out to investigate crimes in Berkeley sororities. All that spring in 1921, the Berkeley police had been baffled by a series of thefts at the all-women's College Hall dorm. So for his control to test them, Larson began with the victim, Margaret Taylor, a freshman who had lost a $400 diamond ring. He wrapped each of her biceps in a blood pressure cuff and wound a rubber hose around her chest to measure her breathing, and then he watched while each device mimicked the actions of her body's inner organs, driving a pair of long, sharp needles that scratched out a silhouette of her body's responses on the skin-like surface of the black smoke revolving paper that you can see up there. Indeed, the pulsating device on its 6-foot plank resembled nothing so much as a mechanized human body laid open for inspection. After a short preamble, he began. Do you like college? Are you frightened? Do you dance? Are you interested in math? Did you steal the money? The tests show you stole it. Did you spend it? And finally, do you know where the stolen money is? The exam concluded, he went on to the next sorority sister until, after going through several, he reached number 17, Helen Graham, a 22-year-old student nurse. When Larson queried her about the money, her blood pressure began an alarming rise before she stripped the apparatus from her body, burst from the chair, and tried to shred the graph paper before she was restrained. Later, the police trailed her to her lover's home, and then, when she finally turned up at the station house in tears, they repeatedly told her that the machine had caught her lying until at last she confessed her guilt. Larson's published paper on the College Hall case launched his scientific career, but it also changed his life in a more intimate fashion as well. It had dawned on him, he said, that there might have been a flaw in the objectivity of his results. What if some of the young women had, quote, been reacting to the questioner and not the questions? So it was in the spirit of scientific disinterestedness that he invited back Miss Taylor, the college freshman victim, for further tests and asked her if she cared for him. She coyly said no, He accused her of lying, and 1 year after strapping her into his lie detector, Larson wed Margaret Taylor. Let's slide up. The machine's appeal was very, very compelling that way. Every single one of the people I'm talking about met their wife on the lie detector test. As time went on, though, Larson began to doubt that he had solved the College Hall case. Was Helen Graham guilty, or did she merely feel guilty? After all, the machine had not, on its own, fingered Graham. Rather, it had succeeded by tightening the psychological screws until she confessed. As I discovered from the archives of the police records, Graham wrote to Larson soon after leaving Berkeley and repudiated her confession. And Larson privately acknowledged that she suffered from delusions. Indeed, while investigating dozens of sorority cases all that next few years, Larson uncovered illegal poker games, petty shoplifters, concealed pregnancies, attempted abortions, often without solving the original crime. As he discovered, even innocent people were troubled by complexes, which had to be aired before the subject could be cleared or cured. And the theft at the College Hall dorm continued after Helen Graham left. Larson decided to leave police work and attend Rush Medical School in Chicago and specialize in criminal psychiatry. Yet for Larson's patron, August Vollmer, the machine promised something grander, a scientific method of solving crimes. Vollmer's central goal was to raise the status of police among respectable citizens by making them professionals, and in fact, making the police themselves law-abiding. And this meant freeing the police from the rule of political patronage and the quasi-legal methods by which they fought crime. In Larson's machine, Vollmer saw a humane and objective substitute for the violent third-degree methods by which the police had long extracted confessions from subjects. His program appealed to the press, eager for stories of true crimes solved by a new kind of scientific justice that seemed swift, sure, and fair. And it made for a great headline. It was the newspapers which baptized the machine the lie detector and used it to offer a voyeuristic tour of the criminal mind, with the reading public sitting in as judge, jury, and sometimes even executioner. In fact, in this Hightower case, he was accused of being a priest killer. Basically, that newspaper headline led a lynch mob to his door the very next day in the cell. So it's not so surprising, then, that old-time cops actually did not embrace the technique. For one thing, police resented outsiders stealing their role as guardians of the public order. And for another, police wielded authority on the streets and in the station house through their power of the bodies of suspects. And finally, cops were actually among the first people to be systematically subjected to the tests. This began under Vollmer and Berkeley. He had basically Larson come in and do lie detector tests on all his own cops to keep them law-abiding. And then, Cleeler actually brought it here to Evanston, as I'll talk about in a sec, and one of the first other, besides Berkeley, other cities in the United States to use lie detector systematically on its police force was Evanston. But what worked in places like Berkeley and Evanston work in a big corrupt city? By 1930, Vollmer, Larson, and Cleeler had all moved to Chicago, the city where the action was if you were into crime, or by extension, a criminologist. Larson, by now a psychiatrist, was working on the South Side at the Institute for Juvenile Research, using the lie detector to diagnose crime as a mental disorder. Meanwhile, Cleeler, along with his wife, Catherine, had been hired on the North Side by Northwestern University's Scientific Crime Detection Lab, the nation's first forensic lab for science, established in the wake of the St. Valentine's Day Massacre under the leadership of John Henry Wigmore. Guys here in Chicago. And there we go, the St. Valentine's Day Massacre. This is a recreation done by the grand jury. And it was one of the members of the grand jury, which was a special grand jury convened because it was worried that the police themselves were implicated in the St. Valentine's Day Massacre, right? The gang had used police uniforms and police vehicles and even police Tommy guns to do the execution. And so the concern was the police were involved. And so the grand jury investigated, and sort of leaders of the community were on the grand jury. And one of them, with the help of Dean Wigmore, the dean of the law school, endowed a first scientific crime lab in the United States and put it at the university rather than at the under municipal control, precisely to avoid the presumption that it was subject to corruption. The idea was here was an institution that was autonomous of patronage politics and that could be trusted to deliver objective scientific data. Larson and Keeler shared Vollmer's disdain for the municipal nexus of patronage, politics, and boodle that governed Chicago. Noting the corruption in the Illinois criminal system, Keeler boasted that, quote, thanks to the lie detector, all this is about to change. I am the first shot from the gun of destruction of political graft and the construction of orderly scientific management. And he trained his detector on the Evanston police and occasionally on the Chicago police as well as the criminals who had made the town so famous. In short, the lie detector belongs to that American strain of the Enlightenment project, which seeks to replace personal discretion with objective measures and replace politics with science. Now, this is not a project which appeals to politicians who want to make patronage appointments or police officers who seek to selectively enforce their authority. By contrast, Vollmer, Larson, and Keeler appeal to the public sentiment that justice depends on dispassionate search for truth conducted by impersonal rules. This logic places the lie detector amid the concurrent American turn to the behavioral sciences to resolve social controversies. Consider the contemporary rise of intelligence testing. In a society in which access to education was increasingly competitive, the appeal of these multiple choice intelligence tests right up to our SATs resides in the way they ostensibly treat all subjects alike, never mind how the questions are slanted. Or consider the contemporary push for Taylorism, also known as scientific management, which used time and motion studies to justify work patterns that conform to the one best way, but Taylorism thereby resolved one of the most contentious issues, right, in labor-management relations. What's the value of labor on a supposedly objective basis? But of course did so by standardizing a more profitable degree of exertion. All of which explains the lie detector's egalitarian appeal in a democracy like the United States. The charade that is the polygraph machine, the hardware if you like, and not the examiner which assesses the veracity of the subject. After all, what could be more fair than a machine? What's our system of justice, right? It's a balance. And what's a balance? It's one of the greatest machines ever made, right? It's one of the first and greatest human inventions. It's a machine. It's fair because it's dispassionate. And that was the appeal of the lie detector and why it's particularly appealing in the United States. It was egalitarian, or more to the point, it gave that appearance. Because in fact, it's not the hardware that counts, it's the software. And neither Vollmer's program of police professionalization nor the lie detector necessarily restricted the discretion of the examiners, who retained tremendous latitude on how to design and interpret the test. And it's here that Larson and Keeler parted company. Larson pursued the strategy of open science because he hoped to adapt his lie detector to improve the science of criminal psychiatry, whereas Keeler pursued the strategy of proprietary know-how because he hoped to make a buck adapting his machine to the marketplace for deception testing. So let's begin with Keeler. For Keeler, success meant seeing the lie detector widely employed and counting the remuneration in his pocket. That's why he sought a patent. Initially, Keeler insisted on retaining veto rights for every sale. He realized the machine itself could not guarantee reliable results, and the reputation of it, and hence its long-term sales prospects, would be diminished if he turned out machines, as he put it, promiscuously to untrained individuals. But when rival devices did appear, Keeler abandoned all restrictions on sales and told his manufacturer just to go ahead and sell to anyone. And more, he began to offer short 2-week courses in which he taught police officers and prosecutors how to do with a lie detector what they had always done with the third degree, that is, extract confessions. Which is why use of the lie detector actually accelerated after the court banned its admission into the courtroom, because the courts continued to allow it to be used in pretrial criminal investigations, firstly, and secondly, because they ruled repeatedly that confessions extracted in that process would be admissible in court. How did Keeler do this? One of his favorite interrogation techniques was known as the card trick. That's it. Basically, the card trick works like this. At the beginning of the test, he would strap the subject in, wire them up, obviously, for recording on his device, and then he would ask them to pick a card, any card from the deck, look at it, memorize it, put it back in the deck. And then he said, I'm going to show you each of the cards in turn, and when I get to the card that's yours, just like all the others, I want you to deny that that's your card. Say no every time. Show them one by one by one. And then he would look at the graphical record produced by the body, and he would say, you know what? You lied when you said it was the Four of Hearts. And he was right every time. And this produced two amazing effects that he really wanted. The first was, it gave them a calibration. What did a person's body look like physiologically when they lie? But that was much less important than the other. He convinced the subject that he could catch them telling a lie. And how did he pull it off? Remember I told you he was an amateur magician? He always marked the deck. Leonard Keeler met his wife, Catherine Applegate, through the lie detector, though she was no helpless victim. She was a fellow Stanford psych major who managed to foil the card test the first time out. How? She didn't even look at the card. But few subjects arrived fortified against the machine in this way. Agnes DeMille, the great choreographer of Oklahoma, was a family friend of Keeler's, and once watched through a one-way mirror as he extracted a lengthy confession from a subject who was initially very reluctant. And she was appalled at how he pulled it off, but she could not help but be impressed, as one choreographer to another, at his performance. In the archives, I discovered the sort of data that the police never publish. A set of surveys solicited by Keeler from police units around the country that showed of the 3,000 suspects they accused of being deceptive, police could induce an average of 60% to confess. Indeed, the machine proved so intimidating that 2% confessed before even being strapped down. For instance, the examiner in Madison, Wisconsin, counted 4 subjects who had confessed simply upon being threatened with the machine, or 5, he noted in the margin, if you count the suicide. Contrarywise, only a tiny percentage of those labeled non-deceptive went on to be prosecuted. The one exception to this pattern was the 6% confession rate at the Indiana State Police, 1/10 the national average. All the others are around 60, this one's around 6. But this is an exception that proves the rule, because in Indiana, the examiner had been trained not by Keeler, but by Larson, who ordered his disciples never to bluff confessions from their suspects, as they might well prove false. This was a noble sentiment, but Keeler's form of bluffing was actually more in tune with the transformation in criminal justice then taking root in America, a system of plea bargaining in which defendants and prosecutors, eager to avoid the risk and expense of trial, engaged in what one law school dean at the time frankly admitted was psychologically more akin to a game of poker than a process of justice. Today, some 90% of criminal convictions are such mutually agreed upon pleas, which is why, even though it has been banned from the courtroom, Keeler's lie detector perfectly encapsulates the American justice system. This game of bluff and bluster also explains one of the great mysteries about the lie detector. Why, despite 80 years of advances in science and physiological knowledge, the machine has changed so little? The answer is simple. Given the nature of the ruse, the instrument's inner workings are almost beside the point. Indeed, police examiners regularly extract confessions by putting on subjects on sham devices. In the 1930s, they would hook suspects up to mock radio. In the 1970s, they put suspects' hands on photocopy machines filled with paper-printed liar. And in our brain-obsessed era, they fit suspects' heads into colanders with wires attached. Criminal naivete of this sort often elicits, you know, a chuckle. I mean, it's, you know, like News of the World. I don't know if you ever read that sort of, you know, wonderful stories of dumb criminals getting caught. But, and in 1997, in a Supreme Court case, in oral testimony, the Supreme Court basically cracks up when they hear a story like this. But I do think the joke is double-edged, right? It's sort of on us as well. Because even though some criminals may be duped into confessing to a mechanical placebo, cops and prosecutors are locked into a self-fulfilling prophecy of their own, deciding human fates on the basis of a hollow test. Of course, for Keeler's strategy to succeed, both to sell his services and to make the lie detector effective, he had to drum up publicity. In this sense, his most influential disciple at the Northwestern Scientific Crime Detection Lab was not a cop or a prosecutor, but a cartoonist, Chester Gould. Gould's Dick Tracy, which was far and away the most popular cartoon and comic strip in the United States for decades, was based on a composite portrait of the members of the Northwestern Crime Lab. Square-jawed, I'm off on my slides, you know, there we are. Square-jawed and incorruptible, Tracy deployed scientific methods, especially the lie detector, as a bulwark against political fix and corruption. Here we can see how Tracy is putting Larceny Lou away, right? And he's going to get her, and she denies it, but the lie detector shows she's lying. That was the last column of the year in 1932 in the Chicago Tribune. And then the next year, beginning of the year, there was a Sunday in between, and then that's the first Monday. And here it is. Basically, it's the same story as Larson's story. Brings in his long-suffering girlfriend, who he never marries, Tess Trueheart, puts her on the lie detector, asks, "Your name is Miss Tess Trueheart, is it not?" "Yes." "You're madly, yea, violently in love with a certain chap by the name of Tracy, are you not?" "No." And then, you know, "Well, for crying out loud, look at, just as I suspected, Junior, she's guilty, just as I suspected." Kind of cute. Obviously, this was part of folkloric stuff within the lie detector community at the time. During the early years of the Depression, Keeler extended this same sort of performance to the world of commerce, using his lie detector to gauge the fidelity of employees. While investigating supposed embezzlement at a North Shore bank, local bank here, Keeler got nearly one-third of all bank tellers to admit to having pocketed small sums of money in their career. The indignant managers were amazed. One-third? And they wanted to fire all these employees. But Keeler convinced them not to fire them, but to retain them and bring them back every six months for retesting. First of all, he said, "These will be the most honest employees you ever have." And of course, it brought him back for retesting, for which he was paid. And on this basis, the lie detector was embraced by the new economy of mass retail and managerial enterprise. Now, Victorians in the old world, the old marketplace of face-to-face buyers and sellers, had relied, as I said, on things like phrenology and character and reputation to figure out who was a con artist and a chiseler, albeit with limited success. And for just this reason, as economic historians have long pointed out, new forms of managerial capitalism in the early 20th century began to integrate, buying up small companies and vertically integrating, using bureaucracy as a substitute for these risky market transactions where you didn't know whether you were getting rooked or not. But could managers really trust their salaried subordinates any more than their Victorian grandparents had trusted hawkers? And here's where the lie detector stepped in. No longer need managers rely on the sort of sentimental avowals which passed for sincerity in Victorian times. The 2 million polygraph exams being conducted annually in the second half of the 20th century suggest that managers expected the lie detector or its intimidating shadow to ensure the reliability of the new white-collar workforce. The pioneer Chicago sociologist Ernest Burgess frankly called the lie detector a scientific aid for social control, a means to deter those in financial trust from yielding to temptation. In a society that was increasingly secular, rootless, and anonymous, the lie detector would act as the nation's scientific conscience. So lie detector became a big business, though Keeler did not profit personally from this expansion. In 1938, the university sold the Northwestern lab to the Chicago Police Department, where it became the nucleus of the Chicago lab and went on to become the nucleus of the Illinois lab as well. So it, in some sense, that institution lives on to this day. And Keeler was let go. The Chicago police had never liked him. He'd always been this sort of cowboy, taking publicity away from them. And they did not like his methods one bit. And then it turned out that Keeler's wife had been deceiving him. The great lie detector was a cuckold, I'm sorry to say. And when she left him for another man, he took solace in drink. He died in 1949 at the age of 45, but not before his final success, selling the US government on his bluff and bluster techniques as a way to protect America's nuclear secrets. Now, this may seem an unlikely alliance. Keeler's placebo in the box, guarding the world's most destructive device. But actually, if you think about it, the lie detector and the atomic bomb actually perform in analogous ways. Deterrence, the name for America's new strategic doctrine, was the very stuff of what Keeler's lie detector was made. In January 1946, when the House on Un-American Activities Committee leaked a false report that Soviet spy rings were operating at Oak Ridge, Tennessee, the Atomic Energy Commission called down Keeler. And for the next 7 years, Keeler and his successors repeatedly tested all 5,000 citizens of Oak Ridge. They unearthed no spy ring, though they did get 9 individuals to admit to have stolen product material, pieces of uranium usually as a souvenir or kind of a joke. And as for those who, quote, sympathized with the communist movement, they turned out to be supporters of federally subsidized housing and the Tennessee Valley Authority. In fact, the people who turned up most often in Tennessee in this period in the late 40s who were un-American were people who had been members of the Ku Klux Klan. Protests by scientists with implicit threats to quit nuclear work altogether actually ended this Oak Ridge program in 1953. And this ironically came just as the United States intelligence agencies made polygraph exams a prerequisite for employment, and allies of Joseph McCarthy deployed the instrument to out suspected homosexuals at the State Department. They would go around and basically try it. As much as we think of the 1950s as a period of the Red Scare, there are convincing cases made by historians that the Lavender Scare, if you like, was just as serious. And you know, there were homosexuals working for the US government. There were very few actual Communist Party members. And in fact, many people were outed and forced out. And it was a way of intimidating the State Department. Just the kind we want. You can see what he's not thinking. In short order, the instrument was adapted to Cold War American politics, trotted out alternatively as a shadowy threat or a theatrical demonstration of public sincerity. At the same time, the lie detector proponents expanded the use of the machine to domains where the credibility of the performance was itself the principal commodity. And it was William Marston who did the most to lodge the lie detector in the American popular imagination. Since his rebuke in the Fry case, Marston had used the lie detector to test the emotional impact of products and to sell them. Here he is, proving that it's very unstressful to use Gillette blades. He also used the device to promote honesty in domestic life, quote, freeing men and women from the twists, repressions, and emotional conflicts that ruin their lives. So here he is in Look magazine, showing that a young bride is kissed by a stranger. She finds it very stimulating. Her husband's kiss is less stimulating, but Marston still believes the marriage can be saved. In 1929, he invited the press to New York to watch while he conducted tests checking out the emotional reactions of men and women while they watched romantic movies. And on this basis, he was hired by Universal Studios in Hollywood to be the first pioneer of audience testing. Basically, he would have people watch movies and record, in a sense, their physiological responses. And on this basis, actually, he had the say on final edits of things like All Quiet on the Western Front and a number of other movies from that era. And then, in one of the great second acts in American history, because of this reputation for gauging the emotional sort of safety and of various kinds of technology, he was brought on board a firm called All American Comics. That was because at the time, in the 1930s, comics were seen as something that was corrupting American youth, ruining their emotional responses because of their violence and their portrayal of women. And so Marston is brought on board as an expert. And once he's inside, he goes on to have the brilliant idea to create the character Wonder Woman. He's the inventor of Wonder Woman. And he designed her. I can talk about this more in questions and answers. Basically, in and around his theories of psychology and his theories of lie detection. So here is Wonder Woman in her guise as Diane Prince, interrogating a subject on the lie detector. He worked into his plots. Here's an attempt by Steve, that's Diane Prince's boyfriend, who doesn't know she's Wonder Woman, right? He's sort of ineffectual most of the time. And in this case, he's tried to get the Baroness, this Nazi spy, to confess on a lie detector. She turns the tables on him. So in the end, it's Wonder Woman using her golden truth lasso, right, which compels honesty. Basically, she's involved in a battle against fascism in these early days of the comic strip when it begins in the around 1940, to basically show that we can fight fascism and propagandistic lies with our psychology and our technology. Marsted did only last one. He never lasted very long at any job, but he only lasted 1 year at Universal. When the studio was preparing to release Frankenstein, the producers actually called on Keeler, I'm moving back a bit in time, to hook up two DePaul undergraduates to his lie detector to watch Boris Karloff bring the monster to life. James Whale, the director, considered this creation scene the linchpin of the movie. To make it credible, he drenched the lab in electrical razzle-dazzle, as much to awe the actors as the audience. As Whale put it, Frankenstein merely has to believe what he sees, which is all we ask the audience to do. And Mae Clark, who played Frankenstein's young fiancée in the movie, agreed, quote, "We actors experienced exactly what future audiences would feel as the film rolled on the screens." So as the resurrected monster and the young bodies, these two DePaul undergraduates, seated in the darkness, shuddered together, Keeler used his machine to record the connection of sympathy and horror that was the physiological index of the film's capacity to suspend disbelief and bring the monster to life. I mean, he's recording, in a way, their responses to the machine. He's recording their belief in what's going on. And on the basis of Keeler's report, the film edits were fine-tuned prior to release to make it all the more convincing. But let me now return briefly to John Larson's response. Larson, as I said, took the route of open science. He published his results in journals of criminology and psychology, and he prided himself on having refused the unethical route of patenting his own earlier device. And as time went on, he became more and more infuriated by Keeler's trickery. He told Keeler to cease a test the moment the subject had any objection. He admonished Keeler to always ask specific questions and not go on fishing trips to turn up ambiguous responses. And he condemned the unethical commercialization that Keeler had cultivated and exploited. For a time in the 1920s, Larson had hoped that the polygraph could be subjected to what he called a standardized, scientific, controlled, objective evaluation of validity. But in 1927, he admitted, "No five of us can agree on the interpretation of a record." But that didn't mean Larson thought the lie detector was useless. In the early 1930s, at Chicago's Institute for Juvenile Research, Larson inaugurated a non-coercive clinical approach to polygraphing using a team which consisted of a polygraph expert, a psychologist, a physician, and a lawyer. In tests of juvenile delinquents, Larson's team was able to clear 20% of cases, elicit confessions from 33%, and he referred the other half of cases back to the juvenile courts with a diagnosis but no claim about guilt. After all, in many psychiatric traditions, a lie is as revelatory as the truth. But as Keeler's technique spread, Larson became embittered. "Beyond my expectation," he wrote shortly before his death in 1965, "through uncontrollable factors, this scientific investigation became, for practical purpose, a Frankenstein's monster, which I've spent over 40 years combating." In recent decades, some researchers and their firms have begun to flog new forms of lie detection, which purport to track deception to the inside of the organ most responsible for lying, the brain. Where polygraph machines assume that lying involved a distinct emotional reaction, these new techniques presume that lying involves a distinct cognitive process. For instance, that truth-telling involves memory, which draws upon particular sites of the brain, whereas efforts at invention are located elsewhere. As if liars didn't have to have superb memories, and truth-telling did not require a degree of imaginative reconstruction. As if there's a single kind of lie, Whereas, as Montaigne pointed out 4 centuries ago, the reverse side of the truth has 100,000 shapes and no defined limits. Moreover, today, these techniques have been tested only in limited laboratory settings, where subjects role play at deception games, and the emotional stakes are deliberately kept very low, lest the cognitive, they swamp these subtle cognitive responses, which is not likely to be the case in any real-life criminal setting or terrorism case. Besides, the challenge of lie detection has always been in devising credible software of interrogation, and there nothing has changed. The hardware has always been what magicians call a misdirection. Over the past half century, hundreds of polygraph studies have been analyzed by committees of scientific analysts. Their conclusion? These techniques do not pass scientific muster, yet lie detection lives on. Or perhaps the lie detector cannot be killed by science because it wasn't born of science. Its habitat, as I've tried to convince you, is not the courtroom or the laboratory, but newspapers, comic books, television, and political theater. So long as it draws its life from our hopes and fears, it will live on, autonomous of its original creators. And that's why there'll always be a sequel. Frankenstein, Bride of Frankenstein, Son of Frankenstein, Young Frankenstein. It would be comforting, wouldn't it, to think that science could sanitize the messy business of extracting reliable information from resistant human beings. Who doesn't want justice to be swift, sure, and fair? But the lie detector, which promises objectivity, has actually thrived on its opposite. Gamesmanship in justice, intimidation in the workplace, deterrence in national security, and theatrics in politics. And as for those daytime television shows in which the lie detector exposes adulterers, there the lie detector is truly in its natural habitat, a technological performance that trumps the performance of deceit. Like any placebo, the polygraph tells us more about the beliefs of the pill taker than about science. Specifically, when it suits us, we believe in the promise of science, no matter how often scientists themselves tell us that we should not trust this Rube Goldberg faith that life's greatest mystery, what's going on inside the head of another person, can be resolved by taking their pulse. That's the allure of truthiness. After all, the lie detector doesn't so much test for the truth as for whether the subject feels he is telling the truth. And as long as it feels like the truth, we can expect the lie detector to survive. Do my little clip.
We're going to run a few tests. This is a simple lie detector. I'll ask you a few yes or no questions, and you just answer truthfully. Do you understand?
Yes.
I'd be happy to answer a few questions. I know we're short of time.
Knowing what you know, and you were accused of murder, and you knew you absolutely were innocent, but the police department that was investigating you, you knew valued, put value into the lie detector test, would you go ahead and take it? Or on the other way around, if you were actually guilty, could you know enough to be sure to fool it?
Right. It's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer. Don't take the test. If you learn anything at the Humanities Festival, you've learned something practical. It is that, but it's that belief that people want to convince the police that they're innocent that gets them started. Or it's phrased the other way. Come on, if you really were innocent, you'd be willing to take the test, right? And it's that power of persuasion that makes it almost inevitable that people, even people reasonably fortified with knowledge about it, are nonetheless sort of tricked into telling it. And then, can you beat the test? The answer is most certainly yes, and it's like Carnegie Hall, practice, practice, practice. There are various techniques. You can read about them on the internet, but it can certainly be beat. Someone else?
We have time for one more.
Oh, only one, okay. Anyone?
Should we have any more?
Yeah, okay. Would you? Whether or not, you know, the courts will allow it. Courts did repeatedly allow in the 20th century that if employers, it's employee hire at will, yes, they can impose lie detector tests as a condition of employment, both at the job hiring moment and ongoing. But in 1988, the U.S. government, federal government, largely banned the use of obligatory lie detector tests for employees unless there were several exceptions. All people working in security areas, including police and the like, can be required by their employer. And if the employer has some probable cause, some sort of basis for thinking there's a problem, they can require their employees to take the test. But as of 1988, lie detector use in the commercial and retail world has slowed down considerably as a result of that law. But it was not a court ruling, it was a law. It was, you know, highly politically contested in the 80s. Okay. Well, thank you very much.